Good morning. Approximately what time 8:30 occurs on a Thursday morning? This is Tuesday morning. Okay. So what any morning? When does 8:30 occur? I was asking them approximately when does 8:30 occur in the mornings. So they are all smiling. For them 8:30 has occurred well before 8:30. I thought I was late because I knew I will take 5 minutes to set things up. But this is later. what do you advise? Because this is not a 1.5 hour class, it's a 1 hour class. And you will have another lecture after this, right? So 9:25 sharp we should quit. And it is already 8:40. So what do you suggest? Okay, to begin with, I'll suggest the following. You come over here and you come over here so that if there are any latecomers, they need not disturb everything and they can quietly go and sit there.
On the system, right? So what is to happen? This is a drama which is playing out at the moment. I've decided to write to Professor Patrick.
No, you already introduced me to them. Yes, last time. Please. please.
Right. So, anyway, I would say this.
Yeah.
So it's very special to us. I'll say that for many reasons. As some of you who interacted with him individually have discovered, but now this is for the rest of you to discover. No more introduction.
Okay. So, I'll try to remember that this is a course on effective communication. What I have tried to do today is to put together some thoughts about what I call situational communication. Those of you who came in late, by situational communication I mean how exactly do we handle ourselves in different situations. Now mostly this course has been about the situation where you are students and you are submitting assignments or you are preparing reports and submitting them. The course has been by and large about that. So to enhance your ability to write well, enhance your ability to speak well has been the main points. However, I submit that there are several situations where you are required to exercise your communication prowess and you still have to be effective in all those situations. As a matter of fact, if you study the requirements of different situations and imagine yourself to be in one of those situations and try and understand and appreciate how best you could deal with that situation in terms of communication requirement, it will probably be useful even when you are communicating normally as a professional. So that's the point that I'm trying. First of all, a brief review. All of us know this. Verbal and written communication is excessively stressed. It is required because the bulk of our communication is like this. But an important point to remember is that we also communicate through our actions. So in fact, before some of you came, the discussion that we had was about cheating. And the cheating is reflected and understood by the other party only out of an action. It is not understood by the simple communication like written or verbal communication. So when you act, that time you indicate whether you meant well or you did not mean well. And it is that action which people take notice of. So your thoughts, for example, as communicated verbally or in writing, make a lot of sense. But unless they are backed up by your action, okay, people will start discrediting even your verbal and written communication in times to come. So the credibility of communication depends not just on what you write, but what you do, what you act. I have also written a common, actually this is not really a part of the types of communication that I mentioned, but I mentioned body language as an independent characteristic which is not significant in written communication sent by post or in text, but any visual communication as in a film clip or whatever video clip, and any personal communication when you are physically present or being physically watched, your body language is of utmost importance. And your gestures, your facial expressions, your eyes, whether you are attentive to people who are listening to your communication, and whether you are listening and not just hearing, whether you are observing and not just seeing, are important. You will be surprised that we are able to detect these subtle changes in the speaker by the body language. I mean, you would have listened to so many lectures, you would have heard so many people, you would have interacted with so many people. You can immediately, instantly guess. You may not be able to articulate it, but you can instantly guess whether that person is looking at you or looking through you, whether the person has you in mind or something else in mind, okay. Whether the person is attentive or not attentive, whether the person is serious or not serious, and whether the person truly desires to communicate what he or she wishes to say or is doing just a task. These are subtle differences. As professionals of tomorrow, you need to understand these nuances and learn to counter them when the ball is on the other side. Namely, you are communicating and somebody else is listening. The body language is of utmost importance, and that is why extraordinary rehearsal is a mandated thing while preparing any presentation. In fact, you would have noticed that many presentations appear very natural without any preparation. They do so appear because they have been extremely well rehearsed. I don't know whether I shared this with you or not, but when I was a young teacher, I used to actually stand in front of a mirror and give complete 1 hour lecture and record it on a tape recorder. Those days we had only tape recorders, the technology, and would listen to that and correct the etc., etc., in order to ensure that my presentation is as best as it could. So it requires that kind of hard work. If you are making a seminar presentation, that is why many times you have these mock seminars. The objective of mock seminar is that you prepare well, time yourself properly. Many people start reading from the slides. That is the biggest nonsense that you can ever do. Never ever read anything that is written in the slide. You are supposed to write some points on the slide, but you are supposed to explain them. As a small digression, I am tempted to tell you an anecdote. This happened in IIT. A person like you, an M.Tech student, he was Professor Sarda's student. I was the examiner, an external examiner and a chairman, final defense. And he had huge slides, points written in details, and he started reading them. So after 3 slides, everybody was getting irritated. Sarda didn't know what to do. The chairman of the defense stopped him and said, "Look, young man, we can also read the slides." So he said, "Sorry, sir," went to the next slide and just stood there for some time. And everybody was wondering what happened. And then after 2 minutes, he says, "Over, sir." So he took that comment so seriously. Now, you cannot have a better example of miscommunication or bad communication than that. So please remember this. Anyway, let me continue with the discussion on the verbal written and other communication. But what I am talking about is situational communication. So different situations, what do you handle things? So first of all, one situation is social interaction. By social interaction, I don't mean a Bonheim and a get-together and so on. Any two individuals interacting is a social interaction. Any group of people interacting is a social interaction, and this interaction is required, is necessary, is part of our lives. Because it is such a natural part of our life, we do not feel, we do not understand that such situations require extra care and extra concern. For example, we are discussing with friends, we are working together days, months, weeks. During these days, months and weeks, certain things will happen. I might make a mistake somewhere. Okay. Somebody else might make a mistake. Somebody else may do a very nice thing. Somebody may be extremely useful to you in some situation. do we always without fail take the trouble of using the following words effectively? Indian communication has not developed to say these things explicitly. Although, like all other human beings in the world, we also go through the same emotional experience. We do feel nice if somebody else does something nice. We do feel bad when we make some mistake. Okay? We do feel very good when somebody helps us. But we often do not explicitly express it. Developed world has figured out certain ways, and when I say developed world, I do not mean only the West. If you go to that era in India, during which India was a developed world economically, do you know what was that era? When more than 50% of the world's more than 50% of the world's GDP was produced in India and China alone. In fact, the Indian and Chinese GDP in that era was larger than the entire European GDP combined. United States did not exist. Do you know what was that era? I'm talking about economic wealth. Which century? Sorry? No, earlier than that. 16th, 17th century, the European Renaissance had started and the European expansion to the rest of the world started. Okay, this was essentially from 13th century to about early beginning of 16th century. And the reason this GDP was so high was because the entire domestic product of any nation or any country or any society was essentially agrarian. The economy was agriculture based. And agriculture means what? More the people, more the production. China and India had very large populations even then. And that is why Chinese and Indian production was the highest. And because the agrarian production was highest, the exchange of barter system permitted Indian traders to exchange this high wealth to get other things from all over the world. And that is why trading was of a great consequence in both China and India, as far as the entire Western world was concerned. During that time, if you look at the cultural development, societal development, you will find that such explicit expressions had become part of the common link. So some of you who would have known or studied or heard, let's say Urdu spoken in North India of that time, what we call an adab, a way of speaking. So if somebody does a good thing to you, people will invariably say shukriya. But we do not say thank you that frequently. Now this is exactly what needs to be adopted by human beings as the societies progress on the path of culture, development and prosperity. We are on that path, and it's high time we incorporate some of these features because they make life extremely enjoyable and livable for all concerned. We mean it, but we don't say it. And because we don't say it, the other person is always worried whether the fellow means it or does not mean it. It's not clear. Of course, it is stupid to say these things when you actually don't mean it. Because the other person, being smart, can immediately figure out that you don't mean anything, you're just saying it for the sake of it. So no make-believe. It has to come genuinely, and therefore you have to learn to feel it genuinely, and then that is true about any communication. Unless the communication reflects your inner thoughts, it is not truthful. And believe me, you may think otherwise, but every human being listening to your communication is sensitive enough to understand whether what you are saying is coming from the heart or is coming just superficial. You can figure it out, right? when somebody talks to you, you can figure it out. You may be nice and polite and not say anything, but you can figure it. But don't forget that everybody else can figure it out too. This is a common human sensitivity, which is available amongst all. So coming back to this, I would strongly suggest, and this has to be practiced, because this is an acquired syndrome. Please remember what I said. Child has some of the greatest psychological advantages in terms of basic characteristics. Curiosity, boldness, perseverance, ability not to give up, and passion and excitement. They are natural. But a child does not have ethics and humility, because these are not natural traits created by nature in its evolution. These are social traits which only human societies have created. And the human societies have created these traits in order to make group living comfortable and enjoyable. Human beings always live in groups. And that is why these traits have to be acquired. Now, since these are not necessarily part of a syllabus in school education or college education, and there are no marks awarded, no grades awarded, probably these are neglected. But it is never late to start with. Some of these I acquired only when I got a greater exposure to the world. And there is no harm in saying, yes, I did not realize the importance, but now onwards I'll do that. Okay. So please remember this. Whenever somebody does anything, and the developed world, it's not just Western world. You take Japan, okay, you take even the hill areas of the world anywhere, whether it is Tibet or Han Mountains in China or Himalayas here or Nilgiris downstairs. If you look at the behavior of people who live on hills, okay, you will find this adab very natural. Helpfulness as well as to interact with others with great politeness is very natural. And I think it is high time we all adopted it. So learn to say thank you, learn to say sorry, and learn to compliment somebody who has done some good work completely unconnected with you. Does not matter. But some appreciating something good. It has to be a genuine appreciation, it has to be a genuine good thing, because it, you see, when you use these words, you are not merely communicating, you are actually thinking like that in your mind. That is how you will use this. So when you say thank you actually thought that yes, somebody has done a good turn. When you say sorry, you are actually learning to admit your mistake to yourself first, which is the most difficult part. The human ego does not permit these things to come out easily. And that is where the cultured human scores over ordinary. And that is what we need to adopt in our own life. Appreciation of good work done by others is important in some other aspect as well, which you will realize when you reach leadership positions. And you are all smart people, you will have an IIT pedigree, you will naturally rise in whichever organization you work for. Within 8 to 10 years, you will be actually working with large groups, at least 10, 20 people, maybe 100 people, maybe 200 people. Those people will then look up to you as a leader. This is not a class on leadership, so I will not spend time on mentioning variety of attitudes and attributes that a leader must acquire. And I don't believe for a second that leaders must be born. There are natural leaders who are born, but leadership can be learned and can be practiced. Restricting myself to the communication aspects of a leader, I would like to tell you one thing. If you have 100 people working for you, and if you make it a point that somebody has done well, okay, you just go to that person and say, well done. Or more importantly, in another group meeting of some 10 people where that person is not there, you say, this person has done this, I have heard, I think that's a good job. You know it, you feel it, but you say it. You know what happens? That person will work with double the efforts. Particularly when that person comes to know that his activities were praised in his absence. That is, by the way, a great Indian tradition which all of us have forgotten. If I want to criticize him, I must do so in his presence. I have no right to say bad things about him when he is absent. If I want to say good things about him, I may say it to him, but in general it's a good idea to say it when he is absent, because then the genuineness is understood by all kinds. Otherwise, wo samne dekha to bol diya. Now you will understand that what I said in the context of a leadership situation, does it not apply in ordinary situation? I have 20 friends, I have 50 classmates, I have teachers, whatever, whatever, and there will be umpteen occasions when you will find somebody has done something good. How many of us make it a point to go to the topper of the class after an examination, where let's say a teacher announces that so many marks were never scored by anybody in last 10 years? How many of us go to him and says, well done, we are proud of you, we are happy to be with you? Half of us feel jealous, sala kahan se aa gaya, and the other half won't care. So please remember this, that a situational communication is relevant in multiple situations, although it is well targeted and well required in specific situations more than others. So do you agree with these observations? That it's worthwhile to adapt, to learn, to say thank you, to say sorry, and to go and appreciate somebody else's good work just out of niceness, reflecting your true feeling. Basically, these feelings are always there. Whenever anything happens, we'll always either feel sorry internally, or we would like to thank somebody, or we would like to appreciate. They are always there, but we somehow suppress them. We don't convert them into action. We don't convert them into words. And in fact, the entire effective communication is about this. Is about taking out the dormant and silent thoughts in your own mind and articulating them properly. But articulating. So that is what I wanted to emphasize here. There are a few more things that, we still have time. Yeah, please. Yes, so what he is saying is that, yes. So let me repeat the question. He is saying that some people may not articulate these words, but they may be able to show those through actions. Okay. You must, of course, show the feelings through your actions. There is no substitute for that. What I am trying to say is that communicating these in words and communicating these in actions are not mutually exclusive. It is not either this or that. In fact, both are important. So he brings out another point, that when I say sorry, okay, it cannot be a mu dikhai sorry. My action subsequent to that event must ensure. I hit you on the head and say sorry. 5 minutes later, I again hit you and say sorry. If you have seen that some taxi number something where Nana Patekar hits that car and says sorry, hits that car again, says sorry. That is not sorry. A genuine sorry is one where you desperately try to avoid repeating that mistake later. That is the action. Yes. So when you take that action, the point is, suppose you have hurt me by some mistake. You have not said sorry to me, but you are now behaving differently. Now that behavior will be noticed by me only when such occasions happen in future. Suppose for 20 days there is no chance for you to make any kind of mistake. Then for 20 days, I won't even know whether you are feeling sorry or not. 20 days later, first time you behave differently, I might notice it. But what would have remained in my mind is the stupid behavior of yours 20 days ago more. I don't know if you have heard a Hindi kahawat, jo boon se gai wo hosh se nahi aati. So what you have lost by one indiscretion is not easy to capture it back by a lot of very discreet things. But still, the actions will speak for it. My submission is that actions alone cannot be a substitute for words, nor words are a substitute for proper. So thanks for bringing out that point that actions are important. Yeah.
There is another important point. The problem with delay is that the victim will keep on amplifying in that time the negativity of that
thing. Oh, amplification, my God, that is a very, very cute process. I don't know, we human beings are very good at amplifying assume thing. How many of you read How to Solve It by Polya? One, two, not read, heard about it. It's a classic book. How many of you have heard of Polya? My God, only 4 or 5. You're all scientists and engineers here. How can you? Polya's counting theorem, pigeonhole principle. In logic, you have not heard these things? Well, Polya was one of the greatest mathematicians in the last century. He has done huge amount of research in maths, but what he has done, in my personal opinion, is the most important thing is to write that book, How to Solve It. That book does not require knowledge more than 10th or 12th standard mathematics knowledge, but he beautifully tells you how problems are solved. And in the process, occasionally he dwells upon problems which are non-mathematical or logical, but they concern logical behavior. So here is his description of a person. So this person is working in an organization, and there are managers which control him and 10 other people like him. He suspects that the manager is against him for some reason. From the last 6 months or 1 year, there are instances indicating that the manager indeed was angry with him, but there are also instances indicating that the manager was appreciative of this person's work. But look at the human psychology. He has decided to amplify the negative instances and remember that the manager is against me and completely forget the other instance. That is again human tendency. At the end of the year, he is expecting a raise in salary like other people. Several other people get the salary raise, he does not get it. From then on, his suspicion that the manager is against him is converted into conviction. And from now onwards, he behaves so badly that he actually makes the manager his enemy. So this happens because human mind is very good in amplifying selected inputs and de-amplifying other inputs. It is a natural human process. Okay. So what he said is correct, that if I let the time pass and if I do not say sorry to you for some mistake, in 20 days, 1 month, you would have actually churned that actual event so many times in your mind that you would have actually decided that I am a completely hopeless idiot and that I am not likely to improve and I am a bad person. And after that conviction, if some action speaks otherwise, you will not take that in. So it is best to reflect immediately as early as possible. We also communicate through our behavior in very many social situations. I will mention a few which are absolutely common and well understood and well encountered every now and then. On the face of it, they are trivial, and that's the reason why we behave the way we behave. Take a traffic signal. If the signal is red, you're not supposed to cross. Signal is green, you're supposed to cross. What do we do? This is an Indian social problem. We will not. We'll stand there, we'll look here and there, and we'll cross. And if the car comes, we'll rush. Many times we'll say, as if we are the policeman on you. What does a car driver do? In fact, in Mumbai used to be very disciplined earlier. Nowadays, not so. But when I tried to drive in Ludhiana and Pune, in Ludhiana, I remember I stood at a junction because the policeman, there was a policeman standing like this and he was directing traffic. I stopped and behind me, 2 or 3 cars started honking. So I looked back and I showed him the policeman. They honked further and that police fellow did this. What was the meaning? So this, everybody is in this. I pride myself in saying that I do not cross a red light, no matter what the temptation. Do you? I learned this. You are talking about West, some of the discipline. in Hawaii, where there was a conference in 1995, me and my wife and some other people from the delegation were being driven to the airport at 2 o'clock in the morning. We had an early morning flight. Nothing, no traffic there. And as the bus was moving, the bus halted at a junction because there was a red light. And you could see it's a plane, you're visible about kilometers, absolutely no traffic. So one of the Indian delegates, because we're getting late for the flight time, and he says, oh, there is no traffic. And you know what that bus driver said? A practically far less literate person than anyone present in that bus. He turned and said, sir, the bus has to stop because of the red light, not because whether there is traffic or not. And that is the discipline. Do we imbibe that discipline? We do talk about others not following it. Do we? Please understand this. This is very, very important because this can be exemplified by an individual. If I decide that no matter what the temptation, I will not cross. No matter what the temptation, I will climb up the bridge while crossing from main gate to the other side. No matter what. Do we dare? The point is, it's always easy to criticize. As you correctly said, several people do not behave properly, but I think the instance must start from oneself. And I think I have no moral right to criticize others if I am not as perfect as is possible. I may not be a perfect person, I may make several mistakes, but it is possible. Do we do this? The second instance I will tell you in social behavior, which is also a way of communicating, is that when you enter a hall, and when there is only one entry, we invariably go and occupy the immediately available seats. We do it naturally. Do you know what it means? We are actually showing the deepest disconcern for people who are going to come after us. Deepest disconcern. We are being impolite, we are being rude to others. Can we not? I do that even now. When I get into a hall and if I am amongst the first ones, I will go and sit in the farthest corner, which is most difficult to access, because there would be people who will come in at the end. And if you do not want their entry to disturb the ongoing proceeding, then the best way is to ensure that they can come and sit quietly. You take a row. You go into the row. You will not go to the middle of the row. You will go to the end of the row and sit there. We do that as a society. That is bad. That is bad communication. You have never looked at it as a communication point of view, right? But imagine if there is a row like this and somebody first comes and sits here. If I sit there, I am actually communicating to others that I don't care about you. You can come and go walk and do whatever, jump over my head and sit in. I don't care. That is what I am communicating. Please understand it from this point of view. I am communicating to rest of my own community, rest of my own friends, that I do not care about your comfort and convenience. I am emphasizing these two cases because these two cases happen 10 times a day in our lives. And if we are not careful about these instances, on every occasion that we encounter them, I don't think we have any right to talk about poor communication or anyone else. We are poor in communication. Okay. Yeah.
But most of the time it happens that the back seat fills first and the front row are...
Correct. See how clever he is. He is immediately ready with the excuse of why he must sit in the front and not in the back. Okay. I was just joking. You are very right. When that happens, invariably, the speaker or the organizers will request people to come forward. Okay. So, but you will agree that that happens only sometimes. And that does not therefore justify our going and sitting in the front. I am not talking about front row. Front row there is no problem. But in the front row, don't sit in the corners as a rule, as a discipline. And if you are my friend, I would expect the following from you. If I come and you are behind me and I sit here and you come, you should say, hey, Fatak, kisak andar. You should say that to me. Because you are my friend. I don't expect this correction in my behavior from my enemies. Only my friends can tell me. But in India, friendship is also very funny. Goody, goody, you know. My, what will he feel? All right? You are his friend, yeah. It's your job to tell him he is doing something wrong. And if he feels bad about it, so be it. If you are his true friend, he will know that you are not saying it out of a khunnas against him. You are trying to correct his behavior. There is absolutely nothing wrong. So please treat the friendship communication also in this context. I mentioned about leadership communication. Critical communication is another fundamental thing of a friendship situation. If you as a friend do not criticize my behavior, there is no other power on earth which will correct me. No other power, only my friends can do that. You must have the courage of your conviction and you must have the confidence in your friendship with me. That even if I shout at Fatak, he will not take it amiss because he is my friend. And I might feel bad temporarily, but I will understand what a great job you are doing by telling me that where I have goofed up. So these are very, very important aspects of communication. Social discipline, I will call this discipline of friendship. There are similar disciplines, I will not dwell over them. Relationship discipline. Parents, brothers, sisters, cousins, relatives. Okay, there are disciplines, but that is not part and parcel of this discussion. We are more or less talking about professional communication, and therefore professional communication will limit our discussion to social discipline communication and discipline of friendship communication. But these are important communications in life. I will tell you, if out of this course you don't pick up anything else except pick up these few things. A, never ever in your life you will cross a red light, no matter what temptation. Believe me, if you start doing it individually, at least your friends will start doing it by looking at you. Changes do not occur by laws, you know, changes do not occur by fiats. Changes occur because the people, the citizens of a nation feel and work and act different. Second, the simple thing, as I said, when you enter a hall, no matter what others behave, you do this. You are sitting, if you are an early entrant, should be such that it leaves maximum leeway and ease and comfortable entry for anybody who comes after you. Because that will also instill in you a natural way of showing concern to others. Believe me, all of us have concern for others. But intuitively we act differently. That intuition is to be controlled by this community. And the first thing that I said, please do learn to say thank you, sorry and well done. I will tell you, if you adopt these, well, no matter how effective your overall communication is, but two things will happen definitely. One, you will feel distinctly better about yourself. You will feel that you have become a better citizen, a better human. And believe it or not, but people around you will immediately start looking at you with a different respect. It will take some time, but they will respect. Good things are respected. Okay? 9:25. See, that's the problem of losing first 15 minutes. I promised them that I will stop at 9:25 because if I stop at 9:30, they cannot go in zero time from this place to another place. Where is your next class? Here only or somewhere else? Nobody knows where the next lecture is. That is very funny. In Crescent. Oh, in Crescent. So you will require 5 minutes. Okay. By the way, I just wanted to take 2 minutes. I had requested for submission of certain stories in your lives and correction to the interview that was submitted. The correction work has been done by most of you. However, you have sadly failed to point out all the errors. Most of you have found about 20 to 25 errors. It is good work, but it is not good enough because, Prakash, how many were there? About 120 errors were there. So if you really go back and take Chicago Manual of Style by your side and start doing it, out of these 120, about 35 or so are disputed between him and me, because he thinks that comma should be there and I don't think that comma should be there, but that is That is because of the differences. How many of you have seen this book? The Chicago Manual of Style. Nobody? Okay, seen. This is a proof editing book. And Ren and Martin, English grammar. Many people have seen it. Some have read it, but nobody has practiced it. So these are important things. I had requested you to write three incidences in your life, and I will tell you, I was very pleasantly surprised to read several instances that people have written. Some have written extremely well. In fact, some people have not written them well, but the intensity of the feeling comes out very clearly. I could picturize the incidents, although the language may not have been correct or something. And it buttressed my own conviction that there are too many decent people in the world around us. We generally ignore them, or even if we notice them, we don't practice what they do. So thank you very much. However, I would have expected the entire class to have written something, because I cannot conclude that 50% of my students in this class have had no incidents in their life, in their entire life, where somebody had behaved ethically differently. I don't believe in that for 1 minute. Unless you have been living in such a cocoon in isolation that you don't interact with anybody in life. When you interact with someone in 1 year, you will find some incidents where that person shines. See, we are a multifaceted individual always. It does not, if I behave ethically in one instance, it does not mean that I will necessarily do so always. There would be temptations where I will misbehave. But even if I do it once, it is important for me to remember it and for others to emulate. Because that is how the ethical behavior in this society grows. Mistakes will occur, but it is not the mistakes that should become general sense. It should be correct behavior that should become a role. So my request is that even others who have not yet submitted that assignment, I had called it an assignment, I don't know, perhaps Kavi, I should have allocated some marks, you know, 5-mark assignment, then I would have flooded with 50 incidences. But I don't believe in that. It's an assignment to bring out your own memories in you. So those of you who have not yet submitted might consider doing that and submit those assignments. But let me tell you, each assignment has been read by at least 3 people. Firoza and Prakash, they personally read them. They have also read it from the point of view of correcting your English. Those things are being done. We will ultimately scan them and put them up for your own benefit and everybody's benefit. And if I have submitted a paper and I find it all, crisscrossed and all, I should not feel bad about it, because everything else is similarly crisscrossed. So there are no problems in that. But I would humbly request others who have not yet written to write. If you can't remember and recall 3 incidences, write just 2, write just 1, but write something. What is important is the incidents, the lesson that you learned from it, and your own expression. Ultimately, don't forget the course on communication, how you express that. It's like storytelling. And one of the aspects of social communication is ability to tell stories well. Okay, thank you so much.